I would like to invite Mr. Avi Armoni, who is a friend of the Gandel family, and he would like to say a few words before we start the forum. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Boker Tov, thanks very much. I'm actually the representative of Gandel Philanthropy in Israel, and I have the privilege of greeting you on behalf of the Gandel family from Australia. This is the annual symposium that Tel Aviv University is holding, and the topic selected for today's symposium is really a subject, an issue, an area that is troubling, intriguing, and interesting all of us, locally and globally. So I applaud Tel Aviv University for selecting such an important topic. And this is not just a great topic, it's an existential one and an important one. And the Gandel family are really quite proud to be associated with such a leading institution. Tel Aviv University is really a leading world-class university that is integrating science with, Mr. Chairman, shalom, is integrating a science, cutting-edge science, with the deepest level of philosophy, social sciences, and art. And the integration of all of these disciplines in an area and a climate of excellence is really what makes this university so unique and such a natural place, General Ben Israel, to hold this symposium. So in the eternal quest to humanity's probably most important and vital questions, Tel Aviv University is leading, and this symposium is yet another example of that leadership. Gandel family, John and Pauline Gandel, are thrilled and are honored to take part in this, not only symposium, but in the contribution to peace, security, and prosperity of Israel, and in this respect also to the region and the world. On a very personal note, to have this symposium, to hold it in the newly built and beautiful, designed and executed Yaglom Hall is a personal privilege to me. So thank you all, and I'm sure we'll have a great symposium. Toda rabah.
Good morning. We have a We have a session today which we will make effort to make as short as possible because I know you are very busy with other events on the Middle East and new emergent threats. And we have a panel. Unfortunately, the head of the National Cyber Bureau at the PM office couldn't come in the last minute. You know that eventually we have a government, and he had other business to do, which perhaps are more important. And therefore, I will try to fill the gap and talk instead of him. And then we have, of course, Professor Asher Sassar, that I'm sure all of you know. For many years, he's a professor at the Department of Middle Eastern and African History and the Moshe Dayan Center for Middle Eastern and African Studies. And he was perhaps one of the first in the Academy who predicted the decay and the falling apart of the Arab state regime, and I'm sure he will talk about new developments in this area. And then he will be followed by Dr. Uriya Shavit from the Department of Arabic and Islamic Studies. So we try to pack everything in 1 hour, and at the end, of course, you can ask questions. We will have 15 minutes or so for questions. So let me start with my presentation. Which will be on a very new threat emerged only in the last 5 years or so, although as I will tell you immediately, it only seems like this. It was in much deeper layers, it was really cooked for 20 or 30 years. And this is what we call the cyber challenge. It all started with this invention of this horrible machine we call computer. As you can see there on the right side, von Neumann with his first computer in 1946. It's not so long ago. And since then, based on the ideas of Turing, and I'm sure most of you saw the imitation games, so I don't have to tell you about Turing. And since the invention of the transistor, which was introduced into computers in the 60s, 1960 was the first year in which someone built a computer with a computer chip with transistor. Transistors are a piece of metal which every year and a half are cut by size by a factor of two. I mean, every year and a half, they become half the size they were a year and a half before. Now, from 1960 until today, you count how many times there is 1 year and a half. Every time it was cut by two, and at the end, we got a huge number. And therefore, this is what we call, by the way, Moore's Law, after the name of Moore, who is one of the founders of Intel, because he already in 1965 saw the direction, predicted it, and founded Intel, which is doing this. And so at the end of the day, without increasing the cost of one chip, we got something like 200 million times smaller chips, a factor of 200 million times smaller chips than they were in the 60s. This is with the same price per chip, per transistor, and this is an enormous cost. And all these machines that we were all accustomed to, like music playing things, CDs, radio, tape, if you remember this tape recorder, this old, you see books, cellular phone, camera, navigating, mail, all these were, you remember this cellular phone? I was in the Air Force and they gave me a cellular phone like this. By the way, some 90% of it here is, perhaps you, is there a way to, no, there is not. Okay, you see? They gave me this cellular phone which was 90% battery and it lasted for 30 minutes. So I had to carry two like this. I was very proud. All these were replaced by one iPhone or cellular phone. This is, by the way, the FBI headquarters, the main file room of the FBI headquarters. You look at it, all of this is now can be stored in a disk on key this size. You see this? This is what happens when every year and a half you cut the size of the machine by two. And we are now on the verge of the next jump, which is the quantum technology. And quantum technology will take us to a wholly different place. And that is a jump by a factor of 10 to the power of 30. I wouldn't try to describe you what does it mean, because no one of us in this room really grasps the size of 10 to the power of 30. It's easy to write. It's very difficult to understand what does it mean. And we are going to have computers like this in the next, let's say, 15 years or so. But what we call cyber warfare or cyber attacks or cyber new era was the world became aware of this only in 2007, the Estonians moved a memorial for the heroes of the Second World War that was left there by the Soviets before they evacuated Estonia. In 2007, they moved it from one place to another place, which was not so respectful in the eyes of Russian patriots. God knows who are they. And they attacked Estonia, first time in history, by using what we call DDoS. This is the simplest way to attack computers. You even don't need to penetrate into the computer. What they did is to overload the channels through which you communicate with the computers. You send a lot of false approaches, and then the channels are blocked. And at the end of the day, no one could use then in 2007 a computer in Estonia for anything. And for 3 weeks or so, Estonia was paralyzed without shooting one bullet. And this caused the whole world to understand that we have a new era here. The next most important event, and I took this one I took from New Scientist, as you can see here, it is attributed to Israel, although I can tell you one of the main problems in this cyber area is what we call the problem of attribution. Your computer is attacked, something happens, it's almost impossible, technically it is impossible, to identify the origin of the attack. You can say that the attack came from this server, but this server got the malware from that server, and that server got it from, I don't know, perhaps Internet Cafe in Paris or something like this. Who really initiated it? This is what we call a problem of attribution. And the reason why people attribute the attack on the centrifuges, the enrichment uranium centrifuges in Iran, to Israel or to the United States or to both, is only by using common sense. I mean, they ask themselves who is interested in it, who has the capability to do it, and at the end they point at Israel or USA or both. But the malware is not written in Hebrew, neither in Russian nor in Chinese. It's written in machine language, and no one can really tell where did it come from. Nevertheless, this attack changed the whole field, and this was 2010. So we are now 5 years from this attack, so it's a very new emergent threat. It changed the whole field of what we used to call information security. People stored information in their computers, and therefore other people tried to steal it, sometimes states, espionage, sometimes for commercial stealing of IP, like it happened or sometimes to sabotage a bank or things something like this. And therefore, all these bodies had huge information security units in order to protect themselves from this hacking. But if you think about what happened to the uranium enrichment facility in Iran, nothing happened to the information there. Information was not stolen or taken or changed or something like this. Although in scientific terms, I mean for computer scientists, mathematicians, etc., everything that is taking bits into the machine and process it and throw out other series of bits, everything is called information, but not in the usual sense of this word. What really happened there is a physical damage to the centrifuge. They collapsed. So one thing that was broken, that it's not anymore on information only. You have to take into account also the physical damage that can come from this type of attacks. Second thing, people used to think that attacks can come only through the net, internet, Facebook, Twitter, only through nets. but the site in Natanz in Iran was not connected to any net, neither to, of course, not to internet or Facebook, but nor to any military or defense internal Iranian network. Not connected at all. Still, someone put the malware inside the computers. And if you think about it, there's no way to block computers from getting malware if one is determined to do it. This computer, for example, that I'm using for this representation, I came 10 minutes before you came. I took my Discon key and I put my presentation there. God knows what did I put there on top of my presentation. Or, by the way, vice versa. What did I receive from this computer on top? What malware did I receive from this computer on top of my personal information? So it's not only about the internet. And the third thing, which is the most fundamental one, is that there are certain machines that we call computers, but there are many more computers than these machines. This one is also a computer. I mean, and every one of you has something like this in his pocket. This is a computer. We call it a phone. It's only in history now. It's computer, and therefore, in this room, there are more computers than people. Because everyone has a phone today, and you have to add all these computers. There is air condition in this room, which is also regulated by a computer. The lights here, everything, I mean, we are surrounded by computer chips. In my car, there are 106 different computer chips. American car. 106 different computer chips. We are surrounded by computers, and all of them are vulnerable to these malwares that we all know by names of virus and things like this. All of them. And therefore, you have to change the whole view from information security to cybersecurity. And physical damage is very important. Trains in Israel, like anywhere in the world almost, are driven by computers. There is one who is called driver there. He has nothing to do with driving. They are driven by a computer. Now imagine yourself, and the computer takes care that no train will meet accidentally another train. Now imagine to yourself that someone is putting a malware inside this computer, and instead of avoiding accidents, it will take care that accidents will happen. You can have hundreds of people dying in event like this. In Israel, we had four stages in the evolution of our thoughts about cybersecurity. The first one started at the beginning of the 90s or even the end of the 80s. And I was then a general in the Ministry of Defense. I had the honor to initiate it. At this, in 1990, this is more or less the year in which the internet became public. It was used before by certain small communities like physicists, etc. But it became public. And we understood that computers, because they all the time they shrink and shrink and shrink, are going to be embedded in any system in the world. And therefore, we asked ourselves, how can we use it as a weapon? I mean, the first idea that we had in the defense community was to use it as a weapon. It took us 10 years or so, second stage in 2002. We already understood that it's not about information, but about physical damage as well. And then we transferred into cybersecurity. Already in 2002, this was 13 years ago. And as a result of a letter that I wrote to Prime Minister Barak, the government decided to a bill to set up a new unit in Israel which will take care of critical infrastructure, cyber, in the cyber domain, critical infrastructure. Critical infrastructure means power production, water supply, things like this, which are essential to normal living. And this we already have for 13 years now. The next step, it was almost 10 years, every step is 10 years after the first one. This was after the Stuxnet of Iran was exposed, the prime minister became very worried about the, he thought, what would happen if someone will use the same technology that damaged the centrifuges in Iran, if someone will use it against us. So he asked me, because here at Tel Aviv University, we were already publishing papers and doing research on cybersecurity since 2003, something like this, since I retired from the IDF. He asked me to lead a task force, a very big task force of something like almost more than 80 people, and to suggest to the government what should be the right policy of the government and what tools should be created in order to be prepared to the new emerging threats. The last stage, by the way, was only initiated a year ago and finished in January, last January 2015, was how do we solve the problem, which is perhaps the most essential problem in this cyber defense. How do we solve the problem of balancing between security and privacy? Because one thing you have to understand that if I want to protect a certain facility, let's say this is the power production facility here in Reading. If I want to protect its computers, I cannot really stay here at the computer and wait for the malwares to come. This will be too late. What I have to do is to catch them in the way. That is, to monitor all the potential servers that can communicate with someone in the electricity company. But all the computers that can communicate with someone in the electricity company means all the computers and servers in Israel, not even only in Israel, even beyond Israel. So in order to protect a certain facility, I have to monitor all the computers in Israel. But then we have a huge problem of privacy, because this time we are not monitoring only the computers of the bad guys, which is always allowed, but of normal innocent citizens, which can be used by the bad guys. And then how do you balance between these two issues? Our chairman has a rich career in banking. Banks in Israel, in 2002, when we defined the list of critical infrastructure, the banks were among, of course, one at the top of the list, because banking system is a critical infrastructure. No modern state can live without good banking system. But banks didn't want to be protected by the government. They wanted to protect themselves. But you cannot really protect yourself without outreaching all the computers in Israel. This can be done only by the government. So you have here a problem, and it's a huge problem. Tension between privacy and security, and in like any problem like this, you cannot really say, okay, security is winning, I will ignore privacy, like the case of NSA that was exposed by Snowden. You cannot say, okay, privacy is the ultimate principle, security is not important, not in the case of Israel. You have to find some balanced solution. And balance, usually we know how to balance when we have a lot, when we have enough experience. But in this case, no one has any experience. It's a new era. In both cases, in 2011 and 2015, we wrote a very thick report, which no one read, but very good executive summary and some very concentrated, very good recommendations. All of them were accepted by the government. The last one was in 2015. This is the cover of the first report. And you see that the goal here, we interpreted what the Prime Minister told us, we interpreted it to include two different aspects. One is answering directly what he asked us, what should be done in order to be prepared to future cyber threats. The second one is totally different. How can we leverage on the fact that Israel started perhaps 10 years, perhaps 20 years before most of the states in the world being involved in what nowadays we call cyber technology? How can we leverage on this and make Israel a kind of world center in cybersecurity? In cybersecurity technology. And only to give you one example, and I will end by this, this is my last one, only to give you one example, since we our recommendations were adopted by the government. In 2013, the overall global market of cybersecurity and services was estimated to be a little bit over $60 billion. The share of Israel in 2013 was 8% of this market. And we are not 8% of anything else. In 2014, it was 10%. What is more pressing is the share in the global market of the investment in R&D, because it tells you something about the future. It was 13% in 2013 and 15% in 2015. And I can tell you that in the first quarter of 2014 and the first quarter of 2015, it was already more than the whole of 2014. So we are in the right way. One of the recommendations that is that we gave to the government, this was 5 years ago, was to have centers of excellence of research at the universities. Because this cyber technology was developed by practitioners, academy was lagging behind, and it's not the right way to do things. So we founded here at Tel Aviv University, we set up the Interdisciplinary Cyber Research Center. We are now 1 year old. We have something like 250 researchers, 50 of them are faculty members. It's one of the big centers in the world doing investing in cyber technology. And the last thing that I would like to mention is that on the last week of June, 22nd and on of June, we have our annual international cyber conference. This will be the fifth one. This will be the first one. It will be like all the other four. It will be opened by the Prime Minister. Thank you. Okay.